Well, good morning to all of you. My name is Debra Freeman, and on behalf of the Schiller Institute, it's my pleasure to welcome you this morning to our conference in commemoration of the birth date of Dr. Martin Luther King. I think that it's most fitting that in commemorating the memory of Dr. King, and for those of you who are from the Washington, D.C. area, as you know, this week has been full of ceremonies and concerts and accolades and breakfasts and other things honoring Dr. King's memory. We at the Schiller Institute thought that probably the best way to do honor to the work and the memory of Martin Luther King was to see to it that some of the goals that he worked for during the course of his much too short life were in fact realized, and realized before the end of this century. And it was with that in mind, with the idea of forging ahead with the principles of progress, of technology, of industrial development, and of justice that were so important to Dr. King, that we would in fact shape the theme and the discussion of today's conference. In doing so, it is my great honor, and I must say that one of the great pleasures of working with the Schiller Institute has actually been the opportunity that I've had through our work to get to know and to spend time with a lady who, without question, is one of the living national treasures of our nation. And probably someday, when the true history of the United States is written, is someone who will be honored as among the key founding mothers and fathers of our nation. She does also serve as the vice chairman of the Schiller Institute. She is a board member of the Martin Luther King Center for Nonviolent Social Change. She's someone who is familiar to many of you here for her work on behalf of human rights. She is probably recently better known to some of you as a rather successful playwright after the events of this weekend. And it is my great pleasure and distinct honor to introduce to you Mrs. Amelia Boynton Robinson.
The pleasure is all mine. I'm very happy to see you. And I wondered what I could say. I would like to say, however, that this is a wonderful occasion when we can get together and talk about those who have given us all that they had, their lives, and what we ought to do to continue. And of course, Dr. King had a dream. We are the ones to fulfill this dream. Because having worked with him from the very beginning, when he came to Montgomery, Alabama, he came there as a minister. And it was very interesting when you think of how he became the president of SCLC. He had been there, been in Montgomery only a year and 6 months. During that time, my sister-in-law, who was a member of that church for many years, said to me, "I want you to meet our new pastor." And I was glad to meet Dr. King, but I had met so many ministers, it was just another man. And I met his wife and fell in love with the little baby, the first child they had. Later on, when Rosa Parks sat on the bus, it was E.D. Nixon, who had been a soldier on the field for rights and for registration and voting for many years, was a man that usually people called when they had trouble. So when they put her in jail, she called E.D. Nixon and said, "I'd like for you to get me out. I'm in jail for sitting on the bus and not getting up to give the seat to a white man." When he came in, he said, "This is it. you are one of our best citizens. We can't let this go on, because others had sat on the bus and others had been told to move and others had been arrested. But you know, God moves in a mysterious way. He selects those leaders. Then E.D. Nixon said, I'm calling the ministers together. He called the ministers together and they came and he told them what happened. And this was two nights after she was jailed. He said, we've got to do something about it. We need to organize. And when he said that that they needed to organize, someone got up and said, yes, and I nominate you, Mr. Nixon, as the president of the organization. And he said, gentlemen, I have been fighting for 50 some odd years for justice and to see that people become registered voters. I am declining, but I'm declining in favor of a young man, and at that time he was in his 20s, who has come to this city, and he seems to be a leader. And I nominate Martin Luther King as leader. And everybody seemed to have agreed with him. And Dr. King became the leader. I'd had much to do with him from the time he became the leader, because my first husband was living and we would go to the meetings in Montgomery, Birmingham, Atlanta, and of course in Selma. But my husband died before it was all over. And I remember the time that Tuskegee Institute gave me a merit award. He was the one who delivered the commencement address. He, at that time, lived in Atlanta. Coming back through Montgomery to get to Selma, he noticed quite a bit of improvement that had been made. And we were in the car, there were four of us in the car. And he said, as he got to the city limits, gee, they have certainly made a lot of improvement. But when we got to a section where the first highway goes into another state, a man drove up as we stopped at the light, and he just looked at us in the car, and Martin was on the side. He looked at us, and he didn't say anything. And of course, we all looked at him, wondering why was it he was gazing. And at the next light, this guy put his window down and made an attempt to pick up something. And at that time, Bernard Lee said, go through the light, don't wait. And this guy came right behind us. And as we ricocheted away from one street to the other, he followed us. And finally, we lost him. And when we lost him, we started talking to him about what was this man's intention. And this was in May 1965. We said, somebody said, well, Dr. King, if they kill you, why, you needn't worry about your family. And I remember he said this, let's not kid about killing. He said, I've done the best I can. I'm still doing the best I can. But I want to live. I don't want to die. And the conversation died off. And as soon as he was killed, I thought about what he said. I also thought about what George Wallace said. When Dr. King was killed, George Wallace said, that's good for him. He got out of his place. He should have stayed in the pulpit where he was supposed to be. And he got out of his place and he was killed. Yeah, he ought to be killed. And some of the members of SCLC got very angry. And one of them said, yeah, we're going to plan to burn down Montgomery. Now, this is going too far. But it wasn't long before George Wallace ran for president of the United States. In fact, not being nominated. And on his campaign, he was shot. Now, we had told these folk who were all angry, don't bother about getting back, that God can do justice better than you can. George Wallace today can't see, he can't talk, He can't hear. He can't go to the bathroom. He's a vegetable. So we let go and let God take over our enemies. We do the best we can, as Martin Luther King did, and let God do the rest. We are on the firing line. We are targeted. And our leader is targeted. Why? Because we're fighting corruption. Anytime you go against corruption, especially when they have a hold on this country or on an individual, then we make enemies. But I have noticed when I first started working with Schiller Institute, every time I called Lyndon LaRouche's name, I could see, I would always look at them, and I'd see them freeze up. Now you call his name, and it's like a hungry person seeking for something, seeking to be fed. And they ask, tell me some more. And that's beautiful. That's leaving footprints on the sand of time. In spite of the fact that this country is in a terrible fix. And if this country is to be saved, we're the ones to save it. We are the ones to warn these people of what's happening. Look at NAFTA. And look what's happening in Mexico now. Did we do any good by sending our industries there? No. But sometimes I think the evil spirit is not only blind, but they're mean, they're hard, they're determined to do what they want to do, and when they see that they have failed, they go into the hole and pull the dirt over them, so that you can't say anything to them. I think of substance abuse and how I talked to a man in Louisiana, one of our members. I said to him, since they have cut your cotton acreage down, why don't you go into cattle business or hogs or chickens? He said, they won't allow us to do that. I can only do what the United States Department of Agriculture tells me to do. I talked with a young man whose parents have a gold mine up in a part of California. And he tells me that they have stopped them from operating, and all of the rest of the folk who have these small gold mines and mines of other minerals, they have stopped them. But a corporation can come in and can buy their claims. There's nothing to stop them from doing that. These claims may be worth millions of dollars. But the sad thing about it is, this country has stopped the appropriation, or has cut the appropriation of those who are doing research work in finding something to combat diseases, antibiotics, and that has been cut. And of course, we know about the privatization, and we know about the struggle that we have, that American taxes are higher in spite of the fact that they call themselves cutting down. And America is not only it's not only the matter of higher taxes, but America is definitely falling apart. We are getting poorer, and the fat cats are getting fatter. But God always has, as we used to say in church, a ram in the bush that he can always call on. And if we don't follow our leader, if we don't go out, you know, just following him, just working with him is not enough. What we have to do is to go into the highways and the byways and preach, and this is the gospel, and preach the gospel, trying to get these young people to realize that they have a part to play. They'll have to lay down their drugs and their pistols and their guns and whatnot and follow. That's where we'll get our blessings. I'm very, very happy that I happened through Dennis Speed, who saw me in New York, and I'm very happy that for some reason he chose to talk with me back there in 1983, and, 79. Wow, now that makes me older than I am. Yes, definitely. Because I was seeking, like maybe like a sinner, seeking help. I was seeking to see what I could do, because I'm going through what I had gone through just a few years before then. And when I told God that I couldn't afford to drown because I had something to do, I had nothing to do. And this guy was designated by God to see me and tell me about this wonderful organization. But I don't feel satisfied just becoming a member. I feel most satisfied when I can go and convince others that we had better get in the march. We had better join hands. We'd better continue to fight for the right that our Constitution has given to everybody. In introducing our speaker, I don't know what I can say that's different from what I have said, but I guess it'll be the same thing. And I'm thinking about a minister, a new minister who went into a community and had a church. And this minister started preaching, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And it was good. And the next Sunday, he began to preach, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And the next, and the next, and the next Sunday, he did the same thing. But this particular Sunday, when he took his text, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand," one of the good sisters called him aside and said, "Brother, why is it you preach the same sermon all of the time? Can't you change?" He said, "I'm not going to change until my sermon has been paid attention to and until the folk realize, until everybody has repented, then I'll change my subject." So I'll change my subject then. We realize that Lynn is a lecturer, and when he went to the colleges and on the campus, he convinced the youth who were at that time lost in a way. He convinced them that they needed to get out and to do a greater task than they were doing in school, because many of them perhaps were just keeping the seat warm. And that is if they sat there long enough. And having no sense of direction, they realized what he was saying. As he left each campus, the wise people on the campus, the young people, the inquisitive, decided that they were going to follow him. Isn't this the way that we built our movement in Selma, in Montgomery, in Alabama, and many other places? Yes, this is the way we built it. We started with the students on high school campus. And when the person was run off of the high school campus, he went to a small college, and this is in Selma, Alabama. But those students that he talked with and he sang to, you know, singing is a wonderful thing. And it's wonderful, because first, it opens up the heart. When he went to the university, some of those students went with him. And when he was run off of the university campus, some of those students left and went with him. Consequently, like a rock that you throw into the water, and it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. That is the way the movement started. my friend, my past friend, George Washington Carver, who's the greatest scientist of Tuskegee, gave to the world 300 plus byproducts from the peanuts and 200 out of the potato. But he didn't do it by himself. He meditated and communed with God and asked him to make him wise to the sweet potato and to the peanut. So has Lyndon LaRouche communed with God, who has received from Christ and from God an unusual, brilliant mind in science, in economy, and in politics. But above all, he has a love for people. The beautiful thing about that is he has no hatred for those who had persecuted him. He feels free to love anybody. Yes, in the face of hatred, prejudice, discrimination, and malice, he's still trying to save the world. That is his objective. And in saving the world, that will include those who persecuted him, who prosecuted him, who incarcerated him, intimidated him, blasphemed him, trumped up lies about him, as we all know, and lied on him. In spite of that, he does not hate them. And they are included in his love. Like Job, Lynn fights against the odds. He says he trusts in God, and though he slay me, yet will I serve him. He found strength he did not know he had. And he has been able to radiate this to the members of Schiller Institute. This is something you don't find in an ordinary person. He's not only interested in saving America, but he's also interested in saving Europe, Africa, Asia, Australia, South America, and all of the territory on the face of the earth. Now that's big. But he feels as though he's his brother's keeper. And if we are our brother's keeper, and the world is peopled, they are our brothers also. He's looking forward to a brighter tomorrow. And we must follow the star of faith and hope. As his great-grandfather or his grandfather had an underground railway station, and many people who were going to Canada had the opportunity to leave and go by the Underground Railway. This trail and what his father or grandfather did, what his grandfather or great-grandfather did, a part of that blessing fell upon him. And had it not been for that particular station, maybe some of the people never would have left and never would have gotten away from the strife and the mistreatment that they got. In 1979 and 1980, when I met Dennis Speed, I was surprised, but I am so glad and I'm thankful to him because of having met him and having led me. And because of that, I think of the song, "You bring the one next to you, and I'll bring the one next to me." And that's what we are trying to do. in order that we may get everybody conscious of the fact that they will have to contribute, and that contribution will be the best that is in them. Lynn is really free. He's free from fear, and he's free to love. Free to love his neighbors, his organization, his enemies. And no matter where he is, he will let them know that his love is great enough to encircle each and every person. I'm about to introduce to you a man who is my associate and who has an organization that we will have to, if we are interested in saving the world and saving ourselves, then he heads this organization, and this organization is going somewhere. When all others decide that they cannot take the pressure and cannot take the fire that will be rained upon them, this organization will stand. And I'm not saying anything about infrastructure and whatnot, because those are the things that will save the world. And I introduce to you a man that God has designated that he may be the leader. And I say to some of you who might know him, and others I introduce to you who perhaps have never known him, the greatest man in the world, Lyndon H. LaRouche.
Thank you for the burden you placed upon me, Amelia. I want to bring Dr. Reverend Martin Luther King back to life, in a sense. In the sense that a part of him, which I probably know better than many people who were close to him while he was walked the earth. I've never had the chance to speak to him, never even the chance to shake his hand, though I lived through the same events through which he lived. And yet I know him in some ways better than most of the people that were close to him, because I know his development. I know a transformation from a dedicated young preacher coming out of Boston University, out of Atlanta, going to Boston to there, going out to take up a parish, then being elevated by a happenstance almost to assume a position of leadership, and going through succession of crisis after succession of crisis. And understanding Martin, I would suggest you look at each of those crises, you look at the action he took, and you look at his speeches, which are half sermon, half speeches. And you'll find something in those speeches, those sermons, which are no ordinary sermons and no ordinary speeches. Because he went, as he did clearly, in making the last address, public address of his life, in reflecting upon the cup of Gethsemane. And he walked to the podium before thousands of people and said, "I am drinking the cup. I wish to live, but I'm drinking the cup." And he laid forth a mission. The difference between Martin and many other people who might envy his position is that they don't understand one thing, that they would have had to give up something in themselves, a reluctance in themselves, to make each of those successive steps by which he stepped upward, faced with a challenge from which many people would pragmatically have retreated. He moved ahead. He found the next higher level of action to carry out. And he not only decided to carry it out, because many of his associates also decided to carry out the action with him. But what he decided was to present the conception of the action to the people in ways that the people would grasp the idea. In this way, Martin Luther King, coming from leadership of an obscure church in Alabama to national leadership and to his assassination showed the same quality we recognize as that of genius in science. The difference between Martin and many other people, that he was a genius. He probably didn't know it at the beginning, but he found it out in each of the steps that he had to take in order to keep the movement going. It wasn't just the steps of personal courage. A lot of other people showed personal courage. They moved their body forward. They went out and organized, and they moved their body forward in that way. But they didn't move their mind forward. Martin was the instrument who did that for them. Martin was the one who, on the platform, went out from the meeting and out from his time in Gethsemane, his own Gethsemane, to give the idea which kept the movement going. He moved not only the people with whom he was associated, he moved an entire generation, my generation. And I can tell you a lot about my generation. It wasn't such great shakes. But I'll tell you about, as I've told many times, my generation, as I came back in 1946 on a boat from India to the United States after completing service, or about completing it, as I rode on that boat, that troop ship, back to the United States, I was convinced that the majority of my comrades who had served abroad in that theater, in India and Burma and partly in China, had seen the reality of the way in which most of the world lived. And that I didn't know at the time that Roosevelt had had those specific thoughts, but we understood, as Franklin Roosevelt understood, that, and as Churchill refused to understand, and as Truman did not understand, that if we did not change the condition of life of people in what was then called the colonial sector of the world, under British imperialism in particular, that our failure to do so would be the seed of a new crisis and perhaps a new war, into which we would stumble by our ineptitude and neglect, as we had stumbled through our folly into two great wars in this century before. I was somewhat mistaken in my confidence, not in my commitment. Within a year or so after coming back to the United States, I found that my friends who had shared, at least ostensibly had shared my concern that we cannot let what the British were doing to the Indians and Burmans and so forth, we could not let that go on in the world. We in the United States had to stop that for our own interest. Well, they believed it, but they didn't have the courage to carry it through. They got back and they were afraid about it after 1946, 47, if some of you lived then, they were afraid about a recurrence of the Great Depression, out of which the United States had emerged in going to war. Along came things like McCarthyism, and people would not look to right nor left, they would look straight ahead and say, that's not my business, I'm not concerned, I'm not involved. They would think 10 times before expressing an idea. They were afraid of depression, afraid of persecution. So they went in the bedroom and made babies and stuck to their last, minded their own business, tried not to. Hey, look, they were not good Samaritans, though they would give generously to education. They would go on school boards in order to vote up bigger school taxes to provide better education for their children. That was a characteristic of the 1950s and early 1960s. They cared as long as it wasn't frightening. Along came Martin and others. Now, what Martin was doing in general was not new. The civil rights movement was not a creation of the late 1950s and 1960s. The civil rights movement has existed as long as there was slavery in the United States. There was always somebody fighting for the same thing. And the level of fight against slavery in the middle of the 19th century was on a higher intellectual level in many respects than was the fight for civil rights in the 20th century. Go back and read the material. Look at Lincoln, look at the other politicians around him. They understood what this was. What happened is you had people like Martin, who delivering a message which corresponded to the message of the circumstances which I saw in India and Burma, responded. You got the Civil Rights Bill not because Martin moved African Americans in the movement and a few other white, guilt-ridden and other well-meaning people. That movement on the streets did not change civil rights. The fight for civil rights had been going on for hundreds of years, as courageously as it was at any time in the 60s, sometimes more so. The difference was that Martin, as a man of genius, typified for the movement the message of the movement. And the message of the movement was a call to Americans and people around the world to create a condition of justice for all persons by this act, and not to stop with civil rights, not to stop with the legislation which had inspired Johnson, had inspired President Johnson. You want to talk about God laying his hand on someone, when Johnson went with civil rights, that was it. You never doubted after that. It was an opportunism. He meant it. He believed it. Just like he believed that three other guys killed Kennedy. But then what happened, of course, in about the time Martin was killed, and it was already in progress in 1966, the beginning of the anti-war movement was the end of the civil rights movement. They were not compatible movements, they were opposite movements. The anti-war movement, remember, when George Bundy finished organizing the war in Vietnam, he quit the job at NSC and went over to the Ford Foundation and organized the anti-war movement. So you have to know that the anti-war movement was really a war against the people of the United States, to destroy our morals. And they did. This was the introduction of what's called the counterculture. The parents at that point, the parents of my generation, saw their children, their bright young children, who they'd pampered and spoiled, and whose morality was not as good as ours was, of my generation. They saw them faced with a draft. They saw their own children in the images they saw on the nightly television broadcast in Vietnam. And those frightened children who had always been pampered and would scream and holler for a new toy they'd seen on television, and usually get it, were figuring out how to get out of this, not how to solve the problem. No one was wrong. I know, I was there, I met them, all. So the Americans of my generation retreated from the commitment which they had made in supporting Martin's message. Not just Martin's message, but he was the voice. They began become concerned with their children and their children's changes of sex and everything else. Their fears. They retreated. Just as I saw them retreat in 1946-48, retreating from the cause of global humanity. So I hope that I can bring Martin alive to you again in that sense. The man of genius, who, unlike most people, faced with the situation, did not try to find the smart way out of the situation and how to retreat, but tried to find the upward way, and did not merely try to find the upward way for himself as an individual actor or a nominal leader like a union bureaucrat or something in the situation, but who transcended that condition with a sense of responsibility to conceptualize what he had learned from this visit to Gethsemane, and to present that conception, as he did in the greatest form in that last public address he gave just before his death, to inspire people around him with an idea which was needed to generate a movement, a new movement forward. Now, Martin's last idea has one which, as Jim Bevel has said, needs to be seconded. It has not yet been ratified and put into motion. People, as I've said many times, after Johnson passed the civil rights law or got it through the Congress, people were told the civil rights had won something anyway. And you could get a ticket. And he would get a ticket to progress, because that's what Martin was talking about. That's what he was doing, going beyond the Voting Rights Act and so forth. Progress, the participation in the progress that the United States had represented by all of its citizens, and true and full participation. And his focus was upon the question of economics and education, but economics primarily at that point. Not as a conception for righting a wrong done to people who are African Americans, but rather that the nation could not be healed unless that justice were provided. And that those who were concerned about the deprivation of their own rights, rather than concentrating merely upon the question of getting justice personally for themselves, like a Sancho Panza looking for a meal, rather would realize that only by establishing this principle, which is already implicit in our Declaration of Independence and the preamble to our Constitution, by making that principle come back alive. So the people got their tickets. They were surprised to have them given to them at the train station, like railroad tickets. And they got on the train. And they could sit in the front or the back or the middle of the train as they chose, they found. With some argument here and there, but nonetheless, in principle, they could. So they took their seat, said, "I'm sitting on my rights." And they waited for the train to start moving. It never moved. The dust gathered and settled upon them. And the man came through, looked like a train official, and he said, "What happened? When's the train going?" "The railroad was just shut down, 1968-69. There had been a cultural paradigm shift over the period from about 1966 through 1968. A paradigm shift which was centered in the extreme radical movements within the anti-war movement around it. That cultural paradigm shift changed this nation from a nation committed to the participation of the citizen in the benefits of scientific and technological progress. Instead, what was introduced in the cutting edge of politics was neo-Malthusian, post-industrial society, and don't be stuck with your own sex, change it at pleasure. Oh, things like that. With that idea, presented by the cutting edge of the so-called intelligentsia from the campus, or the majority of them, who either bought it or were soft on it, and the parents who, to reconcile themselves with their children, began to vote liberally for it. That changed America, and over the past three decades, in that way, the United States has been transformed from a great nation going forward into a has-been going backward. The conditions of life of every person virtually in the United States, at least the average, in every category except the parasites, they are worse off in demographic characteristics, in standard of living, in education, and about everything else than they were in 1966-68, their parents. Everything is worse. Everything is collapsing. Public infrastructure is collapsing. What's left of the schools is being stolen by a bunch of pirates who are called privateers because they own a couple of congressmen. They're stealing the medical care system, which we used to have. You can go up to New York City and get pictures of the medical care system that existed in New York City in 1968. Now go up today to get pictures of the medical care system. New York, get the records. What happened in 1968? If a woman or a man in New York City fell on the streets and someone said, "Get a cop," did they get treated? Yes. They might go to Bellevue, which wasn't a nice place, but they were, at least they were taken care of. And then there was somebody come around and argue about who's going to pay for it. But they were cared for. Not today. They can die of a common cold waiting for somebody to check their credit cards. That everything that we had is being stolen from us. Our conditions of life, our expectations are worse. Our education is an abomination. Most people graduating from colleges today would not be qualified to graduate from a good high school in 1968 because of the education they're getting. And the cultural level, which they're getting through the news media, the entertainment media in particular, television and so forth, they are being destroyed, not uplifted. The train stopped. Now, I want to give you a total of five images in order to try to make clear to you the concept which I wish to present. The first image is Martin. Martin is a true genius, a necessary human being for all humanity, and a symbol because of what his ideas and what his development represents, a symbol for an essential ingredient of the United States and the policy, the global policy of the United States today. The second, I want to present a much less pretty image. There's a building in this city which is occupied by an institution called the Heritage Foundation, sometimes called the Heretic Foundation. And in this institution, there is a Clockwork Orange facility where they train elected congressmen into zombies. And from this building recently, there emerged a crowd of these glassy-eyed, chanting zombies marching like the Night of the Living Dead down the streets toward the Longworth building on Capitol Hill. And in the front of the procession, there was a knuckle-dragging specimen called Rush Bozo Limbaugh, bumping his knuckles along the street as he led them to intellectual purity in the basement of the Longworth building. These are called the neoconservatives. Now, these are not going to be very popular people because they're the first burglars that ever stole grand amounts of money without using burglar tools. They're privateers. I have an image of, you have this Captain Bly, or Captain Blackbeard Bly, Phil Graham, coming off the pirate ship with a Jolly Roger flying. It's called Free Trade, Jolly Roger image, the right image there. And behind him you have a bunch of people in handkerchief heads with cutlasses coming over to take over the nation. And I would call this collection, if it was going to be a painting, the privateers. They're going to steal everything. And they're going to steal and loot the nation through an instrument called capital gains. You pay more taxes, you get less, and you pay off the pirates through capital gains. The parasites who make no contribution, who survive on lucky money, which they get by running a crooked wheel called the speculative, financial speculative market. The people behind Orange County and so forth and so on. That obviously is that image of these things marching into the Congress. It says, well, we haven't got much hope now, have we? What little we had is being taken away. But they can be defeated. They should be defeated, and they can be defeated. But they can be defeated only if we have a clear idea of who they are, what they are. They're not necessarily bad people. You know, who knows what they were would be if they weren't brainwashed into this neoconservative state of mind. Rush Limbaugh followers. But they are an instrument of something that is evil, which has to be defeated, which must be set back in the next weeks ahead, and must be defeated and thrown out of the Congress as a force within the next 18 months, by the time of the next primaries and the next presidential election, primaries for the presidential election. Then there's another image, a bigger image, which helps to put the two first images, that of Martin and of the Limbaugh procession of the Night of the Walking Dead down Pennsylvania Avenue, put that into perspective. And the image is the image of all mankind prior to the 15th century in Europe. All mankind in every culture, every so-called civilization, up until about 600 years ago, was a failure. Every culture was based on a tiny, tiny minority, usually of the form of an oligarchy, sort of the gods of Olympus in mortal form, who presided over and ruled over society by arbitrary, by capricious decrees of a bunch of powerful families, pretty much like the Wall Street families today. And they had a group under them, lackeys, servants, soldiers, whatnot, who administered the mass of society at the pleasure of the oligarchy, like the British monarchy. But underneath it all, more than 95% of humanity lived in a condition of slavery or something approximating that. That is human history in one side up until the Renaissance. That most of humanity lived, in terms of any form of statecraft that existed, lived for the pleasure of a strata of a few small families. This principle, which pervaded and polluted history until modern times, is best called oligarchism. Don't say that slavery was started in the United States 400, 500 years ago. It did not. Slavery, or something equivalent to it, was the normal condition of 95% of all humanity under all societies prior to the Renaissance. What happened in the Renaissance? Well, in Christianity, for example, in Moses, in Mosaic monotheism, we have known for now nigh on 3,000 plus years, according to the book of Genesis, that was wrong. We have known for over 3,000 years, when the first book of Moses was written, that man was created in the image of God, the individual person. And as Philo Judea said, this is an efficient creative power of intellect, the power to create conditions which have not existed in the world before, which no animal can do, the power to change mankind's behavior, to increase man's power over nature. If man had been a monkey, as Prince Philip professes he himself to be, a higher ape, then mankind's population would never have exceeded on this planet in the past 2 billion years more than a few million individuals. So don't monkey around with human culture. Disastrous results. But up into the 13th, 14th century in Europe, the human population did increase, as no animal populations could have. Precisely through this great creative power, which is a practical reflection of the gift to mankind of being in the image of God, each person. But society was not in accord with that principle, but nonetheless that principle worked, despite the fact that the form of society did not recognize it efficiently. Several hundred million people were reached, between the times of the Roman Empire and up to about the 13th, 14th century. That's about the high level of population on this planet. We now have over 5 billion people, an increase which has occurred entirely during the past 500 years. And we could have, with the existing technology, if we used it, we could support 25 billion people approximately on this planet in the level of comfort of a middle-class family in the United States in 1966-68. And don't worry about breathing space, just go to Belgium and Netherlands if you want to see something crowded. Or Hong Kong, Milton Friedman's paradise. Singapore, you want to see congestion, see it there. What happened essentially was the introduction, through the influence of the Council of Florence, of a new form of state called a commonwealth. the term was later used to mean other things, but it was then called a commonwealth, as it was used in France under Louis XI. But Louis XI acted under the inspiration of the Council of Florence directly, and also directly under the influence of a teaching order of that period called the Brotherhood of the Common Life. And France was organized and doubled its per capita national income within the 20-year reign of Louis XI as a result of the introduction of these new ideas of statecraft, including an emphasis upon scientific and technological progress. This success in France, although it was a limited one, and it was a lot of back and forth, as French history will tell you, nonetheless, this became an inspiration to a group called the Oratorians and others, such as Erasmus, who tried to organize this form of society not only in France, in Spain, there was a movement in Spain based on this, in England, around Thomas More and so forth, as examples of this kind of thing, around the predecessor of Henry VIII, Henry VII. And out of this, there came to these shores, out of these ideas, a group of commonwealths. At least 10 of the 13 colonies, original colonies, were founded as commonwealths. Not merely in name, but in substance. The idea, essentially, as Louis XI put it, is that the individual must live for the kind of society which lives for the individual. You will find this same idea expressed rather plainly in the preamble to our federal constitution, in the general welfare clause. As a result of the influence of science and technology, the important role of education, a new kind of education, pioneered by institutions like the Brotherhood of the Common Life, there was a fundamental change in society, its demographic characteristics, rate of population growth, which has zoomed hyperbolically in rate over the past 500 years. The problem has been, as the image, the first two images, between Martin standing on the mountaintop, in effect, his last address, and the Rush Limbaugh mob of Jacobins marching down the street to serve the guillotine or something, that's been the problem of society. We've had on the one side in modern society, modern European civilization, which has increased the level of population and welfare of people on this planet generally over what they were before. That must not be forgotten. But at the same time, there were those who have opposed this, who have opposed the attempt to bring the benefits of society to all members of society, according to the Commonwealth principle, on the assumption that every member of society is in the living image of God, and therefore must be developed accordingly, and must be afforded the opportunities of practice and benefits which befit that condition as a commitment. Now, Martin understood that in his way, and Martin's enemies are typified by the Rush Limbaughs marching down the streets to the Longworth building from the Clockwork Orange factory at the Heritage Foundation. These people who are called conservatives, what are they? Conservatism of this type, of the Friedrich von Hayek type, of the Ludwig von Mises type, of the Rush Limbaugh type, of the George Bush type, of the Pat Robertson type, of the Jerry Falwell type, of the Milton Friedman type, of the Phil Graham type. What kind of conservatism is this? Fungus in a bottle? No, what is very simple. Read, 2 weeks ago, Lord William Rees-Mogg, one of the deans of the British monarchical press, who stated that at his intention, like that of Alvin Toffler with his crazy third brainwave, to return society to a condition in which, as he said, approximately 95% of the population is uneducated, uncouth, is returned to a condition like that of man under feudalism, in which a small group of educated and privileged, sitting on places like the Isles of Jersey and Guernsey, make money by peddling information and the rest of the humanity. What does that mean? As you will see, the impact of the contract on America policy, which is being pushed through the Congress. Mankind's ability to support a population of 5 billion people on this planet, to lower the death rate, the mortality rate for every age interval group, that depended upon scientific and related discoveries, which gave us the technology of production by which we are able to increase life expectancy, which we're able to sustain more people per square kilometer in a higher standard of living, which per capita we produce more. Per household we can support larger families who can live longer. We don't kill grandma because she's just reached retirement age. You give her a watch and poison. Huh? Well, that's what the conservatives are going to do to you, one way or the other. If you reduce, if you change the policy, so we no longer have education, we no longer have a commitment to scientific and technological progress, we no longer have a commitment to the family. That is, you can't do something, you cannot pass laws that injure the family as an institution. If you do, those laws must be nullified. If you don't have that kind of policy, then you go back to feudalism. What does that mean? It means you go back to the population levels of the 14th century Europe and the 14th century in this planet. What does that mean? Several hundred million people. We now have 5 billion, 5.2, 5.3 billion people. What do we do with the difference? What do we do with the 5 billion people who are excess if we have these kinds of policies? You have it, death with dignity, right to die movements, all of these things are all part of the process. The privatized prison system, which are nothing but Auschwitzes. All Adolf Hitler did in 1934, when they were complaining, like Governor Allen of Virginia, about crowded prisons, because they were throwing too many people in prison. We have the highest level of incarceration of our population on this planet. About 0.5% is in the prison population now. It's the highest level on this planet. We must be either we are the most criminal people on this planet, or we have the most crooked justice system, or some combination of the two. That's what that evidence tells you. Maybe we got more crooks in the Congress too. Who knows? What this does, Hitler did, was very simple. He said, we're putting more people, politicals and others, in the prison system. Brandenburg is overcrowded. We're going to take a leaf out of the book of the Quakers. The Quakers were running work camps over there in the 1920s. They had some outside of Brandenburg in Berlin. And they said, we're going to create work camps, privatized work camps. We're going to take the prisoners, we're going to make a contract with a private company which will provide work for this slave labor, will pay it, and will pay the government for use of the slave labor. Auschwitz, which was created by E.G. Farben under the direction of the uncle of Olaf Palme, in collusion with the Rockefellers and Royal Dutch Shell, that was Auschwitz. And what we are creating in the United States and Britain with privatized prisons is nothing but the same things the Nazis did by taking Quaker work camps and putting barbed wire around them and turning them into slave labor camps or facilities to pool labor. And what the labor do? The labor would go to work, say, E.G. Farben at Auschwitz. The labor would get paid in the terms of about 1,200 calories of some kind of indifferent soup per day. The caloric consumption of tissue of their bodies from work and conditions of life was about 3,000 plus calories a day. In about 3 months, an able-bodied slave delivered by the Gestapo SS to E.G. Farben by truckload from the camp at Auschwitz would be returned for replacement parts because they've been turned into human skeletons. That policy, that philosophy is exactly what you got in the United States today in the name of conservatism. That is the philosophy in privatization of education, the same thing. I'll come to that later. But that's what our problem is. We have conservatives who want to turn back, who like Lord William Rees-Mogg, the man who said President Clinton a few weeks ago, President Clinton is a dead duck. An unfortunate choice of term. But this crowd, these are your conservatives. These are your Rush Bozo Limbaughs. These are the bowels of ancient history, the dregs, the gutters of historical past. So the problem that faces us, can these people, who maybe they're individually redeemable, one would hope so, can these people, so-called conservatives, be converted back to human beings? Or can their impulse be frustrated, and can we turn the clock back toward progress again, where it was left off back in 1968 approximately, about the time Martin was shot? Can we reawaken the spirit of Martin Luther King by reconstructing that spirit accurately in our own minds and making that a factor in the way we address the problems of life today? Can we do that, and can we make that efficient? Can we change society? Yes, we can. Indicate why. As I've indicated before, but I'll make it the summation. Now, another picture I want to give you, having given you these three pictures, the world system is collapsing. What we have done is when these fellows back in 1961, because it started with the founding of the World Wildlife Fund, when these fellows decided to change the cultural paradigm, to turn back the clock of history from modern society back to feudalism or something more primitive, what they did is they stopped scientific and technological progress. Now, in point of fact, I won't go into the details right now, but in point of fact, you cannot have profit, true profit, sustainable profit, in a modern industrial, agro-industrial society without scientific and technological progress. What progress is, economic progress, or profit is simply the increase of what we call the free energy of the reproductive process over the energy of the system. That is, if we take you have a certain level of productivity, a certain potential level of productivity, your family members do. And to have that standard of living, you have to have longevity. You can't have your children going to school until the age of 25 if you're dying off at the age of 40. You cannot have modern society in Africa, in black Africa, because the people die too young. Babies don't grow up to the point that they have babies. They die in youth before they reach sexual maturity. The parents don't live too long. They die of diseases, hunger, all kinds of things from that kind of society. They die. Now, how can a person who dies at the age of 40 support two or three children in college to the age of 25? How can that society, on the average, support that kind of education? How can, therefore, they have modern society without the demographic characteristics of modern society? So that determines a certain level of infrastructure and income and so forth required to maintain a healthy population. That's your cost of doing business, so to speak. Now, the creativity expressed in such forms as scientific and technological progress enables labor to increase its productive power and its power over nature with new technologies. This creates profit. The investment of this profit in expanding production and improving its quality, its capital intensity, and so forth, this enables society to progress. And what happens if you reverse that? Remember, for over 500 years, the general trend in European civilization has been technological progress until about 1960-65. That was the policy of the United States from its founding. That was the policy which the United States fought Britain in two wars. That was the policy which is embedded and the purpose and motivation for actually having the Philadelphia Convention, which founded the Constitution of the United States. That was the intent and the efficiency of the United States. That was what made the United States an inspiration to freedom-aspiring people throughout the world in the 19th century. Now suddenly someone comes along from England, Prince Philip, whose family tree is full of monkeys, and says, no, this has to stop. World Wildlife Fund is the mother institution for destroying civilization. If you trace out all the organizations that come out of it and the people who work for it. Since about the middle of the 1960s, about 1966, under Johnson, there was reversal, the introduction of what was called the Cybernetic Society or the Post-Industrial Society, all these kinds of things. And since that time, by 1971, the United States net expenditure for basic economic infrastructure was net negative. That is, we spent less in maintaining and improving infrastructure than the cost of maintaining it in its previous state. We lost railroads, we've lost water systems, we've lost urban systems, our cities are junk piles. Why? Because we did not restore, renew, replenish, replace the things that we were using up. As a result of that, there has been actually a negative growth in physical terms, not in money terms, but in physical terms in the U.S. economy since about 1970-71. And that rate of contraction has been accelerating. Now, at the same time, you have on the one side, and this is global, on the one side you have globally a contraction of the standard of living and productivity of the human race per capita of the labor force, per household, and per square kilometer. That's the pattern. At the same time, you have a vast growth in money, all speculative. In 1946-48, approximately 60% of the U.S. labor force was producing tangible goods. And up until 1966, if you were a member of a so-called minority, and you were poor and you came from the South, your chance of getting into society meant getting usually a factory job or something similar and working your way up from there. If you couldn't get a factory gate to get into, you generally were not going to make it up the ladder. So that's the kind of disaster we faced. Now we have over $300 trillion a year at least, $1 trillion. Many times the total product in money terms of the world. These trillions of dollars, largely in the form of derivatives, the thing that brought down Orange County and bring down other things around the country, these derivatives are demanding debt service or an income stream to keep themselves alive. They're like a cancer eating at the body. Ultimately, the income stream comes out of the body of the physical economy, comes out of taxes. It comes every time someone says, let's cut the capital gains tax rate and increase the taxes on everything else. Let's take away schools in order to give a capital gains bonanza, in order to enable the federal government to pay more debt service to the Federal Reserve System so it can support these sharks. If you look at the growth of monetary aggregates, we have a financial cancer globally which is sucking at the economy, and every time it sucks at the real economy shrinks. And every time the vampire of the financial system takes a bite of blood, it gets bigger and it needs more blood the next time around in order to keep itself alive. Its appetite is increasing. We have come to the point that thing is gone. What you've seen is not necessarily the final phase of the system, but what you've seen in Orange County, in Mexico, in Brazil, in Venezuela, in Peru, in Argentina, and so forth and so on, in Italy, in Spain, and so forth and so on. What you're seeing is a phase of an inevitable collapse of the entire international global financial and monetary system. The death of the system. That does not mean the physical economy has to die, but that means that either governments come to their senses and put the central banks and the financial systems into bankruptcy reorganization in order to have an orderly collapse and keep the economy going, or the failure to bankrupt these financial and central banking institutions will mean a chain reaction collapse in the form of a disintegration collapse. And that is coming on fast. I don't know, I don't think anybody can say what date that would occur. But it's close. You can feel the heat of it now. So therefore, we are facing, during the next 18 months, we're facing a turning point at which the conflict between good and evil, the impulse for progress and the impulse for the satanic oligarchical tradition of the gods of Olympus, are in a conflict, and they can no longer peacefully, pragmatically cohabit the same planet. The system in its present form is doomed. And therefore, the opportunity exists to introduce a change. These are going to be times of trouble, times in which not only institutions will collapse, but ideas will collapse. I'll give you one example of this. Let me tell you the truth about World War I. A truth which most of you don't know. And most, but the reason I tell you something you don't know, which is, will shock you and will sometimes offend you, is I want to exemplify to you how nations are destroyed. Now, people who watch television, particularly kiddie television, will tell you that there are big, powerful forces that come in from outer space and crush you. That's not how nations are destroyed. Nations are generally self-destroyed by stupid ideas. That is, by acting on false belief, people destroy themselves. If you want to know how the British Empire ruled the world, it was not through force. They used gunboats and they used force, but it was not through force. It was by being able to control the ideas of nations. And thus, as long as people believed that they had to behave in a certain way, they would behave in that way. And then a force like the British Empire could manipulate the ideas by which were people acted upon, and thus induce them to destroy themselves. It's like taking a herd of animals, wild herd of animals, and making them into tame animals. You go into this country, and you find these wild animals. You need some herded animals. You need some meat and milk. So you take the animals, and you round them up, put them in a corral. Then you do some selective breeding. You take the ones that don't obey, and you chop them up for food right away. The ones that are docile, give a lot of milk, a lot of meat, you breed with those. And what's been happened to human beings, you cannot control human beings by breeding. Look what it's done for the royal family. You control human beings by intellectual breeding. Human beings are creatures of ideas. If you control their ideas, you can control them. I'll give an example. This is World War I example. Now, I was recently, just before, week before Christmas, I was at the place that the first battle of World War I was fought. And that first battle occurred on September 2nd, 1898, about a year after the birth of my father, at the junction of the Blue and White Nile in Sudan. It was the Battle of Omdurman, which Lord Kitchener, together with the grandfather, Pasha Boutros-Ghali, of the present Secretary General of the United Nations, came down with a well-equipped troop and slaughtered about 30,000 troops of the Khalifa, the independent nation of Sudan at the time, and took the joint. Now, the reason they did that was not for any reason of any war with Sudan. They had a war with France. That's why they went down there. On the 16th of that month, they went down to another place called Fashoda to realize Kitchener's actual objective, was deliver a message to Captain Marchand, Jean-Baptiste Marchand, a French commander of troops who was on that part, the southern part, was sometimes called the Nilotic Southern Region of Sudan. In order to deliver him a letter from a fellow called Theophile Delcasse, a French official, ordering him to allow Kitchener to exit his troops from the country. That was part of the process through that military action that the British induced France to get rid of all the patriots from government and put in a group called the Revanchistes, who were British lackeys. This became known as the Entente Cordiale. The reason the British did this was to break a treaty agreement which had been negotiated by a French foreign minister, Gabriel Anatole, who was a protege of Pope Leo XIII as a French politician. Anatole had negotiated through Count Witte, the leading official of that time in the 1890s in Russia, a nest of agreements which were intended to involve Germany, which would have organized all Eurasia on the basis of railway-centered development corridors reaching from Brest in France to Japan, Vladivostok, and into China, and down into India, and down into Baghdad, of course, which is the German part of the project. The British were so concerned the development of these railway-keyed land bridges across Eurasia that it would destroy the possibility of a British empire. And therefore, they were determined to set the partners in this project, Russia, France, Germany, Italy, so forth, Japan, at each other's throats. The British orchestrated these events by manipulating first the French, but also the Kaiser. The Kaiser would not support the French on this issue against the British, because the Kaiser was pro-British, or at least pro-British monarchy. And thus, the way that Germany was destroyed is that Germany, by failing to support France repeatedly, even though one French minister at that time was willing to do so, by failing to support France on that issue against Britain, Germany found itself in a trap where Germany was destroyed in World War I. And even that would not have destroyed Germany, because Germany, if it carried out the Schlieffen Plan according to orders, would have won World War I within several weeks. But because the Kaiser was pro-British and wanted to have a war with France, not British, he realigned the troops differently as a result of the Kaiser and von Moltke's changing the troops. The long war of World War I occurred. So we can say that Germany, among other nations, destroyed itself by bad ideas. Then, after the Versailles Treaty, these bad ideas became general. Let me talk about the United States in the same context. Until McKinley was shot by an assassin brought into the United States by an admirer of Teddy Roosevelt, who was then vice president. The assassin was brought in by Emma Goldman of the Henry Street Settlement House. And the relevant agencies refused to take the warnings of the New York Police Commissioner that there was a threat to the president's life, McKinley's, from the Henry Street Settlement House. She brought the assassin in, took him out to Cleveland, gave one of her typical speeches about killing the tyrants, and he went off and shot the President of the United States, who died a few days after the incident. And Teddy Roosevelt became president. Now, if McKinley had not been shot and Teddy Roosevelt had not become president, World War I could not have occurred. Because without U.S. logistics, in support, full commitment of logistics to support Britain in a war against Europe, Britain could not have fought a war against Europe. At that time, McKinley, like the typical patriotic president, was, as had all patriotic presidents, from 1776 until 1901, every patriotic president of the United States recognized that Britain was the number one enemy of the United States, that Britain had organized the Civil War, not some group of free-thinking something or others, to destroy us. And that our best friends in the world were Meiji Japan, Germany, and Russia, because France had become in large part a British puppet during most of the 19th century. Teddy Roosevelt, whose father was or his uncle was a traitor to the United States, who worked for the British, was a traitor to the United States, Captain Bullock. Teddy Roosevelt flipped the policies around, and the United States became an ally of Britain and France against Japan, Germany, and Russia. So the reason we had World War I is because we, the Germans and others, were fools. Fools in the sense that we believed ideas or came to believe ideas which are contrary to vital interests and contrary to truth. Because we allowed ourselves to be manipulated because we weren't sufficiently critical of ideas and thought too much in terms of opportunistic terms rather than principle. The same thing happened in World War II. The people who were British, like George Bush's daddy, worked with London to put Hitler into power in Germany. And George Bush's daddy, Prescott, did it on orders from his boss, who was Abe Harriman, the great democratic liberal, whose one of his most important achievements in life was to put Hitler into power in Germany. That's a lesson in liberalism, which was done on behalf of the British monarchy, which didn't have the money to do it at the time. Now, in order to do that, they overthrew the von Schleicher government, which again was trying to solve Germany's post-war problems by cooperation, establishing cooperation on the continent of Europe. Charles de Gaulle, for example, is a typical on the French side of this tradition in France. So what the British did, they used a social democrat, a trade union leader, a member of the Social Democratic Party of Germany, to bring down the von Schleicher government on a vote, and then used the money, which was passed to Hitler under the pen, the signature of Prescott Bush, George Bush's daddy, to put Hitler into power, in order to ensure a war between Germany and Russia. Again, balance of power, or balance of conflict, the same way they created World War I. And we dumb Americans, we still believe that Germany caused World War I, World War II. We believe it. We even are dumb enough to vote for George Bush, or to allow one of our neighbors to do so, without sending him to a psychiatrist first. We allow that, and so it's our own stupidity. Now let's take the case of, finally, the case of Martin Luther King's idea. Martin said some simple words which anyone who's a Christian in particular cannot rightly deny. That all men and all women, as individuals, are created in the image of God. And therefore, the policy of society must be brought into accord with that fact. And that's the way we make policy. When we look at conditions of life, which are the fruit of policy, or policies that should have been made, and those conditions are not remedied when they need remedy according to a principle, don't let somebody come in with a cheap, flimsy idea of how, for practical reasons, you should allow that to go on. Now, you may have to be practical in the sense that you cannot always succeed. You cannot succeed in a moment of your choosing. Therefore, you must organize and prepare for a moment of your success. What Martin said, and what is exemplified by his address, his last address, is what needs to be done. Not just for African Americans, but for everyone, in order to have a nation in the world in which it's fit to live, which these great injustices are no longer tolerated, which the right and just conscience of mankind becomes more efficient or less inefficient. You cannot create paradise, but you don't have to create hell. Now the time has come in order to work for success. The ideas were always right, but there's a time which is often beyond our control, which chooses us to come forth and justly struggle for success, for those ideas. In other times, we can only work to build up the forces which will, in due course, struggle for truth. But the moment of truth comes. And I would suggest that between the two images in Washington, separated by about 26 years, Martin Luther King's last address and the image of that chanting bunch of glassy-eyed zombies marching down the street from the Clockwork Orange factory to the Congress, led by Rush, Bozo Limbaugh. Those are the two movements of current politics and current world politics present. They are moving under the auspices of the greatest crisis of the 20th century and the most profound crisis of its implications of the past 500 years. They are moving within a fishbowl which is about to be broken. This is coming to an end. And the time has come now to prepare to act and to begin to act. Because the moment of truth is approaching. And when we look at Martin, we think not only, remember him not only for his ideas, but remember him for that which made him a leader. And try to find in yourself the equivalent quality. When you are faced with a challenge, with a threat of defeat, do you, like Sancho Panza, go practical on us? Or do you concern yourself only with your own personal position? Or do you bring that within you, that creative power, which is the distinguishing gift of man in the image of God? That creative power, do you apply it to the problem that we face? To participate in developing the ideas which, given circulation, can give a movement the identity it requires to do the job which it is destined to do and must do. Can you find in yourself some of that quality of Martin? Can you develop and purify yourself to find in yourself something of that quality of Martin rather than Sancho Panza? If you can, if enough can, we can win. And the time has come to win. And the time for preparation is going very short. Thank you.
We do have time for questions. There is a microphone set up right in the center of the room in the center aisle. I would ask people to line up and to please identify themselves before they ask their questions. Don't be bashful.
Who should I address the question to?
London? Whoever you have a question for.
Okay. All right. My name's Rita Nicho. I'm a volunteer with the Schiller Institute in Norfolk. And Mr. LaRouche, you keep referring, okay, well, I believe what you say that, you know, human beings have the creative capacity which separates us from animals, but I was just wondering, how you view evolution, like, do you think, I mean, I believe in some of the theories that evolution's putting forth that, you know, the world started probably as an ocean and algae was probably the first life forms that existed and somehow human beings evolved, but, you know, some people in the organization say that we could not have evolved from apes. So I just wondered what you thought.
Well, I think there's some people who went the other way, went back to the ape, devolved, but that's another question. At least they claim to have done. Prince Philip claims to have gotten back to his ape identity or whatever it is. But no, very simple. This is a theological problem. It's also a scientific problem. Men and women often underestimate God, and therefore they create problems by doing that. If you have a Platonic background, as I do, there's no problem. Because in Plato, we say God is the unhypothesized. Let me just put it this, let me give an example, because it pertains to what we were talking about before, about education. Now, what do I mean by good education, and how does that pertain to this particular question? Because the two are connected. Between 400 and 200 BC, a number of discoverers, including a fellow called Aristophanes, measured the size of the earth approximately. That is, the diameter of the earth, he came within 50 miles of the actual diameter of the earth. The important thing here, which I think we'll see, I'll get to your answer for this one. The important thing is, no one, until modern times, had ever seen the curvature of the earth. No one. No one. So how, if you didn't see the curvature of the earth, how'd you know the earth was a spheroid, and how'd you know how big it was? Well, obviously, there are a group of measurements, experimental measurements made, which consists of measuring angles and so forth of the declination of stars and suns and eclipses and whatnot. And by these measurements, which are fairly elementary, done with the equivalent of sticks and stones, no telescopes, he made these measurements and came with a very good measurement of the size of the arc of the Great Circle from Alexandria to Rome, Aristophanes. And there were a number of other measurements of the same type made then. Now the question is, the empiricist will tell you, and this is the trouble with some people trying to interpret the Bible, we don't say, I read these words and they mean this and this, but they're not thinking scientifically, will tell you that your ideas come essentially from intuition respecting sense perceptions. And these, you don't know anything if you haven't experienced it. Well, how do you know the earth is a sphere if you haven't experienced even the curvature of the earth? These scientists did. Because there's a principle of discovery which is the basis of proof and the basis of knowledge. Knowledge is not animal knowledge, the knowledge of sense perceptions. No animal can do that. Only a human being can discover without perceiving the curvature of the earth that the earth is a spheroid and even come anywhere near to measuring its size. But yet a man who never saw the curvature of the earth knew the earth was a spheroid and came within 50 miles of measuring the diameter of that planet. They also measured in similar ways as something he'd never seen. How can you see the distance from the earth to the moon? Can you stand someplace? Can you measure it? Can you measure that? Can you see that distance as a distance? Of course not. Well, how'd they measure it? How'd they know it? Well, they did a better, worse job on trying to measure the distance of the sun by the age of eclipses. But they understood the concept. Right? So, discovery, the fact that all human knowledge is based on this principle of discovery rather than perception, should tell you that, and the fact that this discoverer of discovery is the efficient means by which mankind increases its power over nature. You say, wait a minute. Physical forces, the way Galileo describes them, that is not power. Power is more the way Kepler described it, that there is a reason in the universe which man is capable of recognizing. And if you can recognize that reason, you can recognize the power that delimits what impulses can do in the universe. Huh? Right, now from that standpoint, you say, well, okay, what is man? What is the truth? Truth is a process for human knowledge. Human beings do not know perfect truth. They can't know perfect truth. Because the limits, there are no limits on discovery for us. We can grow, we can develop. But what do we know of truth then? What we know is that the process of discovery, a valid discovery, represents truth. If I can discover principles which are better than those I believed I knew before, then the process by which I make these discoveries is itself reveals the shadow of truth. Now Plato said this idea of hypothesis, of developing hypotheses, is what we call becoming. Kusa dealt with this on the question of evolution also back in his time, Nichols Akuza. But what stands to with hypothesis? That is unhypothesized good or God. Yeah? So God is a different ontological state, a higher ontological state of being than we think of in terms of sense perception. And that's where these questions come in. In dealing with theology, I'll take a limited amount of the Old Testament, particularly the first book of Genesis, and then I stick to the New Testament. And if some of the things in the other part of it don't make sense, well, I don't worry too much about that. I'm like Erasmus on that question.
Hello.
Go ahead.
I'm to identify myself first.
Unless you object, yeah. Oh,
no. My name's Beth Haviland, and I'm from New Jersey. And I had a further question for Mr. LaRouche about the answer you just gave. I was at Aristophanes between 400 and 200 BC. Which circumference of the earth did he measure?
He measured the arc of a great circle from Alexandria in Egypt to Rome in Italy.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Mr. LaRouche, my name is Emil Jetmar, and I'm a volunteer with Schiller in Baltimore. Given the fact that we're going to have a banking collapse, and you mentioned our system is collapsing, does it mean that the federal government of the United States will collapse? And when it does, if so, does that mean we can revert right back to our original Constitution and eliminate thousands of ridiculous laws and also agencies that should never have been in the first place?
Well, let me put it this way, practically. Yeah, it does mean something like that, but not, let's be more precise. We have a president. And this president, whatever criticism you want to make of him, has a virtue. The virtue is the British monarchy doesn't like him. And that's a great virtue. His virtue occurs like that. Now, FDR was not the greatest man in the world, but the British didn't like him, and he had some virtues. Kennedy was not a man of perfect behavior, wasn't my ideal family man, but he had virtues, they didn't like him either, they killed him. So you have a man who is not perfected, but who's president. And if we can keep him alive, we'll be president at least until January of 1997. The crisis will likely come in that time frame. That is the point of decision. Well, now if you're a statesman, as I am, I'm not president. If I were president, it'd be easy. I could tell you exactly what's going to happen. I'm just a statesman, and I don't generally believe in passing along notes to presidents and telling them what to do. I might make known to them what I think should be done. That's a different story. And try to, because they were going to have to, when they make decisions of a tough type, they're going to find they have to call upon every resource in themselves in order to make that decision. And therefore, having somebody give them advice does not give them the internal strength to make the decision, even though the suggestion you would make would be the right one. So that therefore there's a certain fuzziness about, and must be about, the answer, because if this man, if he's alive, he's going to have to make that decision. And the important thing, what considerations should he have to bear in mind and others have to bear in mind as we approach that decision? The United States in 1789 was bankrupt, as bankrupt as it is today, approximately. When Washington was inaugurated in March of 1789 and brought in Hamilton as his Secretary of the Treasury, They put into motion a system which is already embedded implicitly in the Constitution in Article 1, Section 1 of Article 1. They put into motion this, what's called the American system of political economy. And they based that on a national banking system under which the Federal Reserve System didn't exist. No central banking system existed. National banking existed. So, what they did is the Constitution provides that the United States, through the act of Congress, controls and issues its own currency. No central bank can be given the surrogate authority to issue the currency of the United States, the legal tender of the United States. So what happens then if we have to put the Federal Reserve System as such into bankruptcy, which is now issuing the legal tender of the United States unconstitutionally, but they're doing it? You've got a Supreme Court that's pretty unconstitutional too. It gets my constitution all upset. What we're talking about, agency, which you touched upon. Agency. You have a president around him. One would say you have to strengthen the presidency and the institutions associated with it to be able to make the decision, which must come down to this if it's going to be successful. It must, in a sense, put the Federal Reserve System into bankruptcy and take control of all the assets of the Federal Reserve System, as you do in any bankruptcy. The government must then go to the Congress and constitutionally have an issue of currency which is going to be loaned through a national banking system to keep the United States in business, to keep people working, to keep essential institutions functioning, and so forth and so on. And just as was done, of course, more dramatic than then, we're now a leading power on this planet, we have more responsibilities and so forth, but just in principle it was done under Washington, who turned a bankrupt nation into a prosperous one. The important thing is to recognize we don't care about all this stuff, we don't care about this paper, who cares about it? It's only parasitical, it's usury, it's getting the money changers out of the temple. Get rid of them. Do it under law, do it legally, do it properly, do it in a way which minimizes chaos, but do it. And the point is to try to keep the economy going without missing a step. But the principle which we have to understand is the principle of agency. We as human beings can only function effectively through agency. We have to create institutions, support those institutions, shape the institutions to do the job that has to be done. And above all, which I think some people forget, you have to also give the institutions the moral strength to do what they must do and to make the decisions they must make. As Martin Luther King did in his way, made his decisions. And that was his genius. You could put anybody in that position, but he had the genius to carry the ball. And let's hope this president has the genius to carry the ball. And let's hope we can do what we can to make sure it goes that way.
Thank you.
My name is Richard McSorley of Georgetown University in Washington. A few days before the day that Martin Luther King was shot, he took part in the garbage workers' march and protest in Memphis, Tennessee. And most of the workers carried a sign, "I am a man," this big sign, "I am a man." Now, Martin Luther King agreed with that, and it represented something of his vision. What do you think Martin Luther King meant by that, "I am a man," and does it agree with your vision of man?
Well, I think I would agree with him. I would support, shall we say, I would support him in that idea. I might have a more complex conception, as I probably have indicated, a more philosophically articulated view of that. But I think that I would find myself in fellowship with Martin Luther King in that action. And certainly, what was done was right. But what I think, what I would emphasize myself, my view, which is, might be the differentiator of my emphasis, as I did in just announcing the question on the question of the curvature of the earth, the idea of creativity, the idea of knowledge. To me, the most important idea, which must be reaffirmed, particularly because of certain changes which have occurred because of Hugo Black and other things in the recent period, where people have lost sight of reality of these so-called theological questions. It is necessary to make clear to people. Oh, let me change it this way, Mr. Sully. We've had this lady's play in scenes down around Washington a few times. And my reports of this are that the children and others who watch this performance are inspired. It's just a drama. It's a truthful drama, but it's a drama. Because it presents a conception, particularly with this scene of the selling of the slave auction, which gets across to these people, and they really are moved by this process. People have to be moved also not only by great art forms, but by educational experience, as in scientific, or like, as I mentioned, this Aristophanes case. When a person can realize that they're not just learning something, but that they are reliving in their own flesh, and with their own mental powers, the same creative act which one of the great geniuses of past history did, which changed history. And then they do that again and again and again in a good education. Then the child realizes, look, I have in me this same quality which the kid who's in the class with me has to replicate in my mind with my creative powers, to replicate one of the great discoveries, a whole series of the great discoveries of all human history. And that's what I can do, and that's what every human being can do and should be doing. He's not a monkey. When people understand that, not only will they recognize the legitimacy of someone saying, wearing a sign saying, I'm a man, but they will not need to, because they will look behind the eyes of that man. And they will say, I can see the divine spark there. I can see that which sets man above the animals. I can see behind that pair of eyes a living person in the image of God. And when you can see that, you come to a higher level. And I think that we have come to such a time of despair, the counterculture, the loss of all morality, even the loss of the belief in that there is a morality, that you've got to get down to fundamentals. And I think that we can do it. I know you've taught, you know something about this, that we have the means, and I think we've got to use every means we've got to get people to go through the conceptualization of that experience. Not to use a word to say that person's a man because they got arms and legs or something like me. But that person is a man, they're not an animal. That's not a gorilla. That's not a chimpanzee. That's a man. That's a human being. It's the same thing we see when we're educating little children. We see little children, we have this great feeling of agape about children, particularly when children are learning. Because we are excited. We are uplifted by seeing this little creature, this little child, go through a learning experience where they're not learning to repeat after me, but they're actually making a discovery. And the beauty of that concept, if it can be captured by movements, will create the most powerful movements. I think that's what we have to do. So I think man, yes, but we've got to present this on a much higher, more profound, and more moving level than we did before.
Okay. I do believe with Mr. LaRouche that you cannot really emphasize the role of education enough in the unfolding of man's creative abilities. Now, my question is sort of a concern. What I've seen and read around the U.S., I am Christiane Nkwedi from Cameroon. Now, the privatization of schools, that concerns me because of the ripple effect that we might have tomorrow around the globe, around the world. Okay, so I would like for you to please to elaborate on privatization of schools, their short-term and long-term effect in terms of education itself and in terms of employment or jobs tomorrow. Thank you.
Well, very simply, that we spend the better part of $1 trillion a year on education in the United States. You have two things going. You have the Lord William Rees-Mogg pipes, or the Alvin Toffler, or Fluffler, whatever you want to call him, who are spreading the third wave that you don't really need education, you don't need this second wave stuff, they call it. And you have the ideologues from Harvard who say that most of the people, 90% of the people, should not get cognitive education, they should get only associative emotional education. And so that's on the one side. That's called outcome-based education, which will destroy education, will destroy the minds of the children. It'll destroy our entire civilization. It's absolutely satanic. It comes out of Harvard, which is where Satan spends a lot of time these days. Teaching, that is, or advising. The other side is you get a bunch of parasites like this EAI grout from out of Minnesota, which is going around like a bunch of privateers, is what they are, pirates who own a couple of congressmen. And they're looking at the $700 trillion kitty there. And they're saying, we can go in, and because school boards and taxpayers are desperate to reduce the tax rolls for everything except debt service, that we can, by telling them, we will shave something off the cost of education, they're going to look the other way if we give the children virtually no education. So they come in with a canned approach, not teachers, but so-called facilitators, not teachers, which means some bum off the street is forced to get a shave, huh? Or something like that. And they bring them in, and they loot the place, as they've done in Baltimore, they've done around the country. Look around the country, this privatization of education is a ripoff. Now, some people then try opportunistically to say, well, this is like parochial schools. That's not true. Absolutely not true. Because what's lost in this process is the understanding that you have to set, what you do in education is you set standards of education. And you say, okay, if you don't want to go to a public school, go to a private school. But we'll recognize that as long as the education meets those standards. If they give you something else, fine, they give you something else. But these areas, these standards must be met. What has been done is they've thrown away the standards. The other part, in the United States, we have a labor force of college graduates who are unfit to employ almost as sweepers. What do they study? They study pseudosciences. All right, 1801. The Madame de Stael, the Madame Blavatsky of the early Romantic movement, France, invented political science, a pseudoscience. French positivists invented sociology, a pseudoscience. Before that, they invented ethnology, a pseudoscience, which later became known in English as anthropology. They invented behavioral psychology, the same people, the empiricists and positivists, a pseudoscience. Then they developed current events. And what these jerks are studying in university, in the name of education, that 80% of the people who are coming out of university do not have useful knowledge. They have actually lost some of their brain power as a result of the conditioning to which they've been subjected. When you see a university that has multiple choice questionnaires, that's not a university. It's a factory producing trained monkeys or something. So the problem we have is, the issue here is the standard of education. I wish my children, and I have lots of them, I have millions of them around the world, implicitly, I'm responsible for them, so we have to worry about them. But I want them to have what we used to call a classical Christian humanist education. That is, to relive as children the great discoveries of knowledge of all history as the child can do that in successive steps. I want them to learn music that way, drama, classical drama, not garbage, not this television garbage, but actual classical drama, which Amelia has learned to do some years ago. It's classical drama. To present ideas not action, not sports, or something like that. Not sports and sex, or whatever they call it. That's the kind of education we have to have. It has to be an education which is attuned to a society which is not only engaged in scientific and technological progress, but also a society in which people are doing things because they have a sense of participation in the human race. Standards.